So you see all those wires on the pole? Well, that's what we're going to talk about. If that's your only opportunity to get internet is through copper services, well, so be it. It's not so bad, but honestly, if you're an internet company or a company that depends on the internet to communicate, or your productivity is important to you, it's not really the way to go. And I'm going to show you why. All right, let's start out with copper. And let's take just T1s for example. We're going to go with the old telephone topology. Now you all realize that a T1 is as old as I am, okay? Pretty darn close. So T1 and Sputnik, you know that little satellite that went up, the Russians sent up and tried to beat the US into space and made a little beep beep noise back down to Earth with the radio frequency? Well, that's how old the T1 is. It's really that old. All right, I'm going to show you some of the problems with this technology, and it's just due to its age. All right, so if you have a signal that's traveling on the copper wire, you've got a clock that's being used, and all these pulses are taking place, and it's all electrical. Well, you've all heard the term electrical interference. Well, that can interfere with things, and then your routers on each end got to resync, and you've lost some packets, so your computers have to repeat. And this happens more often than you might realize. And go ahead and look, and you'll find that T1s also have this, it's a topology over the top of it that started in the telco industry, you know, more than 50 years ago. For example, a T1 isn't straight packets moving across there with, you know, nice characters and stuff like Ethernet. What it is it's broken down into channels. And so each channel is 64K bits in size. And of these, there's 24 channels. And you get out to about 1.5 megabits per second. Now there's one extra bit left over, it doesn't really matter, and it's how you get up from 1.54 to 1.8 or something like that, but it just doesn't matter because this isn't going to be around much longer anyways. So if you think about it, you've got your data is now being spread out between 24 channels on a single copper circuit. So these two wires of the T1 are separating that out. And then there's this clock that's taking place on each one of these, and channel timing is going on, and there's all kinds of interference that can happen here with your T1. I see these people, I say, well, you know, you need a little bit more internet here in order to handle what you're doing with your application. And they go, oh, we'll get another T1 and we'll tie them all together. And so it's, you know, why tie together more 50-year-old technology? It's just, it doesn't make sense. If something else is available to you, your productivity is important. The T1 is old. Old news. You've got a new company. What are you messing around with old technology for? Even the old companies don't use this anymore. So you don't want to play with the T1s. Now, what we could do here is the next, we'll go ahead and show you what's wrong with all those. Now, there's also DSL. DSL is got the same kind of problems as the T1 has. Okay, again, it's another topology, it's a little bit different. Electrical interference interferes with it. By the way, if you have DSL lines, T1s, and ISDN lines all next to each other or close to each other in the same cable in your phone room or out in the street or on that telephone pole or in that box, they actually interfere with each other. The other thing that affects all of these things is the weather. Any of you who've had some basic physics classes know that, you know, when you heat up air, it expands. When you heat up copper, it expands and contracts. This affects, because it's all electrical, this affects things like the impedance matching, and you're going to start having data not working so good sometimes, and you're wondering why it doesn't work good. So just the heat, the contraction of the cold, and the heat all have an effect and play a role on the reliability of these services. Now we'll get into coax cable TV. It's a little bit different. Instead of it being electrical, it's radio frequency. So on a coax situation, what we have here, maybe I should actually leave all of these things up there so that you see what affects it, but basically just about anything you could think of affects these things. Great thing about fiber is the electricity doesn't affect it, the heat doesn't affect it, it's light, and there's not too much that changes light. All right, so on coax cable, so we've all seen the cable TV that you connect in your house, and there's a connector on the end of it, and then there's a little wire there, and this is called an F connector. And what happens is it's right here, there's a separation. And if you go look on yours at home, it could be stretched apart. Remember we talked about hot and cold. Well, the reason I talk mostly about hot and cold in the weather is because that stretches apart. When that happens, you know, rain gets in here and that starts to affect the electrical characteristics of this, if it'll still work at all, if rain squeaks in here. But you know, the wires, the coax cable TV wires hanging on the poles, in that shot in the beginning there, on that telephone pole, you will notice that the cable TV is on one line on the pole, and then the telephone lines are on another. And so it's all hanging there, susceptible to the weather. And when this separates, remember I told you that this was RF. Because what is cable TV? Well, it's very high frequency and ultra high frequency radio signals. So in that megahertz range there, what we have is just about anything else can leak into this cable. So it's a closed RF network is what cable is, cable TV. So on the coax, you have other radio frequencies leaking in here. And then you get harmonics distortions where it's kind of a doubling frequency. If this frequency is half the frequency of the other one, then it starts to hear, and your little devices start to hear signals from the other frequencies. And that's called harmonic interference. And so you have this problem with cable TV also. So basically, if you're trying to run your business on a copper topology, you're either really susceptible to weather, you're really susceptible to, if you're running coax, radio frequencies, you're really susceptible to other types of electrical characteristics, and even the same type of technology in the same cable. Now, but what's the worst part of all of this? This is the main reason to stay away from copper. Who's climbing these poles? And who's opening up these boxes? It's a whole different set of engineers. These people are the cable TV guys climbing over those telephone wires or next to them, and he's bumping them, and they're getting stretched. He's even I've seen him hang their tools on them, not the nice big cable with the nice metal support on it, but some of the little ones underneath, and that stretches them out, and then the connection's not so good, and you hear static. Well, when a TV guy goes out there to repair stuff, you're susceptible to him bumping something. When a telephone guy goes out there, opens up one of those boxes and hangs his equipment next to it, like in that photo, and he touches things, he's looking for pairs because some old lady down the street or some old man down the street called in and said they can't hear anymore on their phone line. So the phone company's being nice and going out and fixing that lifeline service for those people. And when he does that, somebody does that, they're going to touch your wires in that box too that are punched down. They're just pressed down to some metal little thing, and you're going to get noise and interference, and all of a sudden your data isn't as good. You're not getting your throughput that you wanted. And that's the problem with this sort of stuff. So you want to stay away from that. Now with fiber, it's different because it's light. Okay, light bends, it goes around a corner, it's moving through this nice piece of medium. It used to be glass. Now most of the fiber is actually a polymer. It's a plastic. And it just stays there, and the heat doesn't bother it, the electricity next to it. In fact, they run fiber cables right in there with high tension power lines with 27,000 volts on them, and it works just fine. You often find that it's used to enter the 220 or 240 volt path into a building. You could just throw it right down there and it'll go right in just fine, no interference at all, not one drop packet. So fiber is really reliable. The other nice part about it is you could just keep stacking stuff up on top of it. There's no telco topology involved. This is Ethernet. So when you've got Ethernet, you know what Ethernet looks like, all kinds of packets going back and forth. There's none of this trying to fit it into channels and your devices on each end changing things. So basically you want to go with the fiber topology if you possibly can. It's worth the extra few dollars. It's worth the production value of your company and the time you save and the frustration of being down or having to have somebody fix something else. And it frees up your IT guys to work on all kinds of other operating system problems or invent new little apps and things like that to make your workflow even better. So I hope this helped you understand a little bit about what goes on here with copper topology versus fiber. You can get to a whole bunch of Fiber Internet Center tools from our fiberinternetcenter.com website, and just go ahead and look for the link that says FiberKnock Tools, and I'm sure you'll find that helpful.